Alright, everybody at home, grab a Bible, grab a Bible. I'm going to turn to the book of Psalms, Psalm 136 and 1. Alright, grab a Bible. Sorry, the bishop ain't here, so I'm doing 8 jobs at the same time. I think there's a rap song like that. 8 jobs at the same time. Alright, turn to the book of Psalms. 136 and 1. Psalms 136 and 1. When you got it, say amen. Psalms 136 and 1. Psalms 136 and 1. Before we get started, let's give God a hand clap. Hallelujah. Amen. About 5 or 6 of us here tonight, but God is good. The Bible says we're 2 or more gathered in his name. God says, I am in the midst. Psalms 136 and 1. Today we're going to talk about God's grace and his mercy. God's grace and mercy. Psalms 136 and 1 says, oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever. Verse 2, oh, give thanks unto the God of gods, for his mercy endureth forever. Verse 3, oh, give thanks to the Lord of lords, for his mercy endureth forever. Verse 4, to him alone doeth great wonders, for his mercy endureth forever. Verse 5, to him that by wisdom made the heavens and the earth, for his mercy endureth forever. Verse 6, to him that stretches out the earth above the waters, for his mercy endureth forever. Verse 7, to him that made the great lights, being the sun and the moon, for his mercy endureth forever. Verse 8, for the sun to rule by day, for his mercy endureth forever. Verse 9, for the moon and the stars to rule by night, for his mercy endureth forever. The Bible says we should be thankful for God's grace and his mercy. God's grace and his mercy. What is grace? Grace is when you get what you don't deserve. Mercy is when you don't get what you deserve. The other day, the young lady was testifying about how she got a ticket. Short story, she said, well, I got this ticket, but I thank God that is teaching me now to slow down. That's called mercy. God is giving you mercy. Grace is when you get what you don't deserve. Most of us have jobs that we ain't qualified for. That's called grace. And we thank God for his mercy. Next, turn me to Psalms 51 and 1. Psalms 51 and 1. Psalms 51 and 1. So we thank God for his grace and his mercy. Because it's nothing but the grace of God that kept me. And his mercy that protected me from my own sins. Psalms 51 and 1. It says, Lord, have mercy upon me. O God, according to thy love and kindness, according to the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgressions. Verse 2, wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. Verse 3, for I acknowledge my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. For I acknowledge my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. What we're going to look at tonight is the fact that David says here, my sin is ever before me. He says, my sin is ever before me. He didn't say this is a temporary thing. Sometime my sin is before me. He says, the sins that I like, the sins that I enjoy, the sins that I can't stop doing, they're ever before me. See, David is like most of us. He's a man wrapped in flesh. And a lot of times, we fall victim to the flesh. David says, my sins is ever before me. But before that, we read, great is thy mercy, great is thy kindness, for we serve a God that's a God of mercy. We serve a God that's a God of kindness. Next, turn to me the book of Romans. Book of Romans. Romans 7 and 19. Thank you, Jesus. We're going to put it all together. Romans 7 and 19. Romans 7 and 19. It says, for the good that I would do, I do not.
but the evil which I would not that I do. Verse 20, then it says, now if I do that I would not, it is no more I that do it, but the sin that dwelleth in me. This is Paul speaking. I love Paul because Paul was a sinner who got saved. And the thing about Paul is, he too is just like many of us. Although he got saved, he still had some sins inside of him that he couldn't let go of. He had some sins inside of him that he couldn't shake. He had some sins inside of him that he couldn't that he enjoyed. Even in the book of Hebrews 11 and 25, it says, sin is fun for a season. Some of the sins that we have gotten accustomed to doing, our flesh still wants to do it. Last Sunday, I went to Carl's Jr. Now, you know the $6 burger ain't no good for me. I'm 52 years old. What? I ain't got no business eating no burger that big with all that grease and mayonnaise and mustard and pickles and everything on it. But I craved that burger. So I had a friend in college. His name was Robert Henney. Robert, I love you, man, if you ever watch this. Robert used to drink Diet Coke by the gallon. I ain't never seen nobody drink that much Diet Coke. He would, like, this was in the 80s. We would go to the store and he would order cases of Diet Coke. And he would drink like 15 or 20 a day. He would just go through them because he craved Diet Coke. Now, some of us have temptations and cravings that aren't as innocent as a $6 burger or Diet Coke. Some of us have sexual cravings. Some of us have drug cravings. Some of us have tattoo cravings. Some of us have adulterous cravings. We have all types of cravings because we live in a body that's full with flesh. But here's what Paul said. This is Romans 7 and 19. He says, for the good that I would, I do not. But the evil which I would not, that I do. And then he says, now if I do that I would not, it is no more I that do it, but the sin that dwelleth in me. And that's a powerful piece right there. Because what Paul is saying is this. He's like, God, you know I don't want to do this thing, but I can't help myself. And I keep doing this thing that I don't want to do. And what's interesting, turn to the book of 2 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians 12 and 7. 2 Corinthians, thank you, Jesus. 2 Corinthians 12 and 7. This is Paul again, 2 Corinthians 12 and 7. And he says, lest I should be exalted above measure, that through the abundance of revelations, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. For this thing I besought the Lord three times that he might take it from me. And God said to me, my grace is sufficient for thee. For my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, I would rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Verse 10, therefore I take pleasure in my infirmities, in my reproaches, in my necessities, key word, in my persecution, in my distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, I am strong. The powerful thing about this passage is this. Never get down on yourself. Never get down on yourself. Never exist in a state of guilt. If you do something wrong, don't beat yourself up about it. Because what the devil wants to do is, he wants you to destroy yourself. It's very sad. A comedian, his name was Jack something. It went all over Instagram and social media. And they found him dead. But what they failed to disclose is that he had taken a gun and he shot himself. This young man was a millionaire. He wrote Blackish, the television show Blackish. Young guy, he was well-to-do. But sometimes the devil will take the things that you don't like about yourself and he'll magnify them and he'll bring them to your attention. Look at what you did. Look at how you did this. Look at how you did that. And he'll cause you not to like yourself. This is what was happening with Paul. Paul had some sins that he couldn't get rid of. And his church friends always talked about him. Man, I saw you over there in the strip club. Man, you over there sleeping with so-and-so. Man, I saw you drinking this. Man, I saw you smoking that. And he's like, God, can you take these things away from me? And God says, my grace is sufficient. That's why we serve a God that's a God of grace and mercy. God is not like man, because see, God can see to the heart. He can see through the bone and the marrow. He can see your very thoughts and hear the things that you haven't even heard yet. God knows you better than you know yourself. So we serve a God who already knows what your proclivities are. So don't let any man judge you for anything that God has forgiven you for. Let me say it again. Don't let any man judge you for anything that God has forgiven you for. For God called you through his grace and through his mercy. Next, turn with me to Romans 5 and 8. Romans 5 and 8. Romans 5 and 8. Thank you, Jesus. Romans 5 and 8. When you guys say amen, I ain't got it yet. Romans 5 and 8. Romans 5 and 8. Romans 5 and 8 says this. But God commended his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more, being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from the wrath through him. God commended his love toward us. Sunday we talked about the fact that love covers a multitude of sins. It talks about the fact that love in our heart will cover a multitude of sins. And then it says it will justify us before God. That's a beautiful notion. Because God died on the cross before you were ever thought of. God died on the cross before you were ever born. And he says, I'm going to shed my blood for people who don't even exist yet. Because God exists in love. You're never more like God than when you love. You're never more like God than when you stand in forgiveness. Because God stands for us and through us and by us in his love. It is love that is key. So we as disciples have to understand we have to exist in love. Next, go to Romans 5 and 20. Romans 5 and 20. Romans 5 and 20. It says, for when we were servants of sin, ye were free from righteousness. What fruit had ye in those things that ye are now ashamed of? For the end of this thing leads to death. Go to Romans 5. So I read the wrong verse. That was Romans 6 and 20. Amen. Maybe we need to hear that. Romans 5 and 20. It says, moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound. But where sin abounded, grace did abound much more. Verse 21. That as sin had reigned in us unto death, even so God's grace will reign in us through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord and Savior. Let me translate that. It says, moreover, the law entered. That's the Ten Commandments. And it says that the offense might abound. I'm going to translate that. But when sin abounded, grace abounded much more. What that means is this. The law came through Moses. That's called the Ten Commandments. Y'all read that later in the book of Exodus. And the only thing that law does is penalize. Law is only there for penalty. What that means is, law is there to persecute you. If you run a red light, you pay $400. If you get a speeding ticket, you pay $500. If you steal something, you go to jail. If you break somebody's window, hit somebody, there's a penalty. Law only exists for penalty. But God said there's something that supersedes the law, and it's God's grace. And it says, wherever you have a sin, it says his grace abounds more. Why would God say that? Here's why God would say that. One day Jesus was hanging out with his partners, and he was sitting down with a group of people they called sinners. And the church people saw Jesus sit with the sinners, and they were like, why are you with them? And Jesus simply said, they that have need of a doctor don't need me. And they were like, well, what do you mean by that? He said, these people are sick with sin. So they need a doctor to be with them. He says, you go over here, you already whole, so you don't need me. And he went and sat and ate with the sinners. The beautiful thing about that is, Jesus is never on document described judging any of the sinners. In fact, when he ate with them, he always came to them with edification. He spoke healing into their life. He spoke love into their life. He never condemned them or tore them down. In fact, the two times that Jesus only got mad was, number one, when he went into church and they were selling things, church people. He got mad then. And he got mad when the Pharisees started talking about those were church people. He got mad then. But he never got mad at the sinners, because he understood that they're already going through something. Because the Bible says the wages of sin is death. They're already going through something. Here's the interesting thing about sin. Turn to Romans 2 and 1. Romans 2 and 1. Romans 2 and 1. Thank you, Jesus. Romans 2 and 1. Here's the interesting thing about sin. Romans 2 and 1. Romans 2 and 1. Romans 2 and 1 says this. Therefore, thou art inexcusable, O man, whosoever thou art that judges. For wherein thou judgest another, thy condemneth thyself. Romans 2 and 1 says this. Whenever you start talking about somebody else, you're condemning yourself. Whenever you start judging anybody else, you're condemning yourself. Put a pin in that. Got something else for you. Put a pin in that. Turn me next. I got another one. God just hit me with it. Turn me next. James 3 and 1. James 3 and 1. We almost done. James 3 and 1. James 3 and 1. And we're going to explain later why we're talking about these things. James 3 and 1. James 3 and 1. I love these little books, but they're so hard to get to. James 3 and 1. I'm about to go to the index. The index is my friend. James 3 and 1. Anybody got it?
Yeah.
Go ahead and read it for me, Doc.
Let not many of you become teachers, my brothers, knowing that as such we will incur a stricter judgment.
All right. James 2 and 1.
For we all stumble in many ways.
Ooh, that's good.
If anyone does not stumble in what he says, he is a perfect man.
All right.
Able to bridle the whole body as well.
Amen. Excellent. My version says this. It says, my brethren, be not many masters, knowing that we shall receive greater condemnation. For in many things we offend all. But if many men, any man offend not the word, the same as a perfect man, and able also to bridle the whole body. Let me read for the Living Bible translations. It says, dear brothers, don't be so eager to tell other people about their faults. For we all make many mistakes. And when we teachers of religion, who should know better, do wrong, our punishment will be greater than for others. That's powerful. That's powerful. The Bible says, don't be so quick to tell other people what they're doing wrong. And the reason why God said that is this. Because if you walk around and you act like yours don't stink, one day your truth will be exposed. For the Bible says, all men are sinners. It's so sad. I don't want to mention any great preacher's name, but back in the day, in the 80s, you had a whole lot of super pastors, and they were mega pastors. They had big churches worldwide, and they covered the earth with all the word of God and 24 hours worth of church. And some of them were very condemning to other people. Some of them used to judge and talk bad about people, particularly for their sins. And they were always, you're going to hell, you're going to hell. It was all that. It was hell this and hell that. But what had happened was, the Bible says, if ye judge, ye too shall be judged. And the Bible says, what happens in the dark will one day come to the light. And the thing is, all men have faults. We're built in this flesh. This flesh is full of flaws. You have your mother and father's DNA in your body. That means you're wrapped in flaws. There's no perfection amongst you. And these men of God who stood before the pulpit and who walked on water and did all these fancy things, people found out what they were into. And they were exposed. And because they were exposed, they look like frail men. But here's what God says. When you see a brother or sister struggling in sin, don't talk about them. Don't judge them. Don't even bring it to their attention. The alcoholic, no, he drink too much. The man who's addicted to pornography, no, he can't stay off Pornhub. The girl who smokes too much weed, she knows she addicted. The girl that got tattoos from head to toe, she knows that. You don't have to bring anybody's sins to their attention. But what the Bible says, what you do is pray. In fact, turn to Galatians 6 and 1. Galatians 6 and 1. Thank you, Jesus. Galatians 6 and 1. Galatians 6 and 1. Galatians 6 and 1. Galatians 6 and 1. Brethren, 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 if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such one in a spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou too shall be tempted. And then it says this, and this made me cry early. It says, bearing ye one's burden, so fulfill the law of Christ. God says, you are to bear each other's burdens. What that means is, if you drinking too much, my job ain't to talk about you and your drinking. My job is to find out, man, why are you drinking? If you smoking too much, if you having too much sex, you're too promiscuous, whatever it is, there's a reason for everything to happen. People just don't do stuff just because they like doing it. There's a reason and a season for everything to happen. And if I love you, my job is to be like, hey man, I'm here for you. I remember I had a friend, he was going through a divorce. And while going through this divorce, it was crazy around his house. He had this chaos going on. And all I did, I knew him and his wife, man. I'd be like, brother, I'm praying for you. And all I would do when I saw the things that they were going through, the stresses, the highs and the lows, all I would do is offer the word of prayer and then speak good things about it. I hope you guys make it through this thing. I understand. Keep your head up. Walk through it. You don't tear people down when they're going through something. You don't heap coals on their head when they're struggling with something. You speak love. You speak positivity. Because what Christ says, we are to bear one another's sins. We are to bear one another's burdens. We are to help them through that thing. The Bible says, two cords, three cords. If there are three cords, it can help one to sustain something that is hard to do. What that means is this. If one person is dragging something, it's going to be hard. But if you get two, it gets easier. If you add three, it becomes stronger. So what does that mean to you and I? Let's start praying more for one another. If you hear tell about one of us that's going through something, don't be so quick to get on your phone. Girl, you hear what's going on? Man, you see that, man? Just start, hey, man, I heard so-and-so is having some trouble. Let's pray for that brother. Let's pray for one another. Because if we're all lifting our voice up to God, and he hears our voice on one accord, the Bible says if he hears more than one of us praying for something, he's there in the midst, and he will answer the prayer. And the very last thing, turn me next. To Hebrews 4 and 12. 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 Hebrews 4 and 12 says this. For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even dividing asunder of the soul and spirit, and the joints and the marrow, and is the discerner of the thoughts and the intent of the heart. For the word of God is quick, powerful, and sharp. God's word is sharp. God's word to be said to be like a knife. So if you have a knife, you can hurt somebody. If you have a knife, you can kill somebody. But if you have a knife, you can also heal somebody. What? You can heal somebody with a knife? Anybody here ever had surgery? Anybody here? One, two. When people have surgery, what happens is the doctor gets his sharp knife, which is called a scalpel. And rather than stabbing you with it, he uses it and he surgically goes in and he carves out whatever the problem is. He takes the problem up, he cut the knee and he put healing back in there, he sew it back together. Here's what you should do with God's word. Rather than using it to hurt somebody, use it to heal somebody. Take God's sharp word and use it as an instrument of healing. Say, you know what? Girl, I used to be just like you, but I got saved and God made me better. Girl, I used to go through this. Man, my wife did this, but man, we made it through. You need to speak healing over folks because people are going through enough hell already. So use God's word to heal. Use God's word to heal. Go down to Ephesians 4:29. I know I said it was the last one, but I had to drop this one in here. Ephesians 4:29. Thank you, Jesus. Ephesians 4:29. Ephesians 4:29. Ephesians 4:29. Ephesians 4:29 says this. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers. When you speak words, it should be words of encouragement. When you speak words, it should be words of hope. But what, you walk around here acting like I'm supposed to be Disneyland. I can't tell people what's going on. If you know they're suffering, they don't need any more bad news. I remember on The Wiz, remember The Wiz, The Wicked Witch of The Wiz. She said, don't nobody bring me no bad news. That was her thing. She said, I don't want no more bad news. I got enough bad news. So as disciples, our job is to speak hope. Give hope. Make people understand it's going to get better. Because the Bible says, weeping may endure through the night, but joy comes in the morning. Some of you are in a season of stress and in a season of peril, in a season of whatever is going on. Guess what? It's only a season. That means if you keep walking through this season, God is going to deliver you. So we don't speak negativity. When somebody's going through, let them know. Trouble don't last always, Big Mama used to say. There's good things that are coming your way. And the last thing, you said that a long time ago. One more last thing, just one more. Hebrews 3:8. That's it. Hebrews 3:8. Thank you, Jesus. Hebrews 3:8. Hebrews 3:8. Hebrews 3:8. And it says simply, harden not your hearts as in the provocation in the day of temptation in the wilderness. God says, don't have a hard heart. Don't have a hard heart. See, Jesus didn't have a hard heart. He had a loving heart. His heart was that of love. His heart was that of compassion. His heart was that of sympathy. He didn't harden his heart and said, you're all sinners. I know you're sick. He walked around and he spoke love. He spoke compassion. He gave everybody hope. That's what he did. And that's why people followed him everywhere that he went. If Jesus was walking around condemning people, nobody would follow him. If Jesus walked around sitting there, you going to hell, you going to hell, you going to hell, I know all y'all sins. He could have did that because Jesus could look at you and be like, "Put," he know every thought that's in your head. But he looked at you. Instead of looking at you, he looked at your heart. And that's what he judged us. When we die and we stand before the altar and the great throne of grace, it's going to be the heart that determines whether you enter heaven or hell. Because God is going to use your hearts. Because in the Old Testament, talking about Saul, it says, God doesn't judge the outer countenance of man. He looks at the heart. So it's your heart. So make sure that your heart is full of love. Some of us need to learn how to speak better. I know for one, I need to stop cussing people out so quick. Matter of fact, somebody hit me up today, and I'm about to go off, and God said, love, and I just, all right. And I learned how to ignore people's negative text messages. Some people can try to irritate you by sending you crazy messages. Learn how to ignore. I guess y'all block them. I don't like blocking people, so I got to stop just swiping to the left. Don't look at certain things. If you know somebody's trying to make you mad, ignore them. If you know somebody's trying to call you to disturb your peace, ignore them. Because some people mad because you're doing what they wish that they could do. Some people are mad because you're in the direction. They see your life headed somewhere that they wanted to go, and they're jealous, so they use that to attack you. So we have to learn how to decipher. Amen. Give God a hand clap. Hallelujah. Everybody stand. Everybody stand. Amen. Give God a hand clap. Hallelujah. Amen. Good to see you guys. We start off in the book of Psalms, Psalms 51 and 3. And it says, our sins are ever before me. Our sins are ever before me. And that was so transparent. That's why I love David. David didn't portray to be a super Christian and a super disciple. He's like, God, I'm struggling, man. I'm doing the best I can. And I love that because that's me. I'm not a perfect pastor. I ain't a perfect teacher. I'm not a perfect husband. I'm not a perfect anything. I struggle just like you do. And when you could stand before God in humility, you're standing for God in truth. And God loves truth. Never stand and try to hide what you're going through. And what we do in society, we hide our infirmity. And I'm at the head of that line. Like my bad marriage. We try to hide these things. And God says, it's okay. You ain't the only one with a bad marriage. You ain't the only one with financial trouble. You ain't the only one with whatever you're going through. If you can stand before God in truth, he will give you enough grace and mercy to get you through the storm and to get you through that thing. So learn how to stand before God in your truth. And then the other thing is, when you see somebody or you hear about somebody going through something, gossiping is fun, and we've all gossiped. Look, man, you get it? Boom, man. We've all done that. But it ain't fun when you're the subject of discussion. Gossip is never fun when they talking about you. When you walk in the room, I don't want everybody quiet. Anybody got something to say? And you're like, wow, that's crazy. So the thing is, we need to learn how to pray more for each other, lift each other up, and give an encouraging word. And God's word is so powerful. It can be used to hurt or it can be used to heal. The old church was very mean because they sent a lot of folks hell. It was hell. Every week was hell, hell. And I remember I went to this church. See, I'm from the South, Uncle Jerry. That man talked about hell for 3 hours. Hell, hell, hell. And my favorite pastor said this. He said, some people talk about hell so much you can smell the smoke. You just smell smoke in the room. And what had happened was a lot of people gave up on God because they thought they could never make it into heaven. I have friends who are gay. I said, I'm going to hell. So I ain't going to church. They tell me that. I'm going to church. They say, I'm an adulterer. I ain't going to church. I'm a fornicator. I love sin. I ain't going to church. And the Bible says, don't turn aside from serving me. Because God looks at the heart. And he knows what your struggles are. None of us can stand before God and say, I'm perfect. God, I ain't did nothing wrong. Look at me. I am awesome. Not a single human that ever existed can say that. So since we're all flawed, and we all sin constantly, every day, every minute of the day, we're all the same. So that means that God is going to look at your sin just like he look at his sin. My favorite bishop, who got 20,000 members, he's going to look at his sin just like he look at the bum on the street corner sin. Sin is sin. But it's grace and mercy that suits my case. So be thankful for God's grace and his mercy. And thank God he wakes you up and he protects you and he loves you and he speaks into you. And try to do more good than bad. Amen. Give God a hand clap. Hallelujah. Anybody have any words? We close it up. Any questions?
No, all right. Everybody grab a hand. Everybody grab a hand.
All right here. Dear Heavenly Father, we stand at the altar asking for grace and mercy. We stand at the altar, Father, requesting that you help us to become better. We stand at this altar, Father, asking that you speak into our lives and to our souls and order our steps so we would do those things that you called us to do. Father, we rebuke the enemy. Father, we rebuke any negative spirits, people who don't have our best interests at hand. And we speak love over this group. We speak health over these young people. We speak prosperity over their dreams and over their families and over their vision. Father, we block out anything that's not of you, Father. Yes, God, we know we make mistakes, but I thank you, Father, for your grace and your mercy. And we thank you, Father, for giving us another opportunity to do those things that you called us to do. Squeeze the hand next to you. I squeeze life into that hand. I squeeze prosperity into that hand. I squeeze vision and purpose into that hand. So that these young people become the head and not the tail. So they become victorious and never defeated. So that no weapon of the enemy shall prosper. And we ask all that in Jesus' name. Amen. Give God a hand clap. Hallelujah. My boy. God bless you guys. I think I'm sure you're going to
be. All right,
we got chicken, nuts.